Hi, I'm Melissa Cobb. Come fly with AOPA. This week, we take a look back at AOPA's most popular videos of the year, two new aircraft reveals, and four pilots who made questionable decisions and found themselves in the FAA's crosshairs. Well, probably the most anticipated aircraft reveal of this year was the Vans Aircraft RV-15. That was a high-wing backcountry airplane, and they released teaser videos leading up to EA Air Venture in July, and we were actually the first ones to get to see it stashed away hidden at Whitman Regional Airport during Air Venture. AOPA pilot editor-at-large Dave Hirschman joined up with Vans to give us an up-close walk-around of the aircraft.
You've seen photos, perhaps you've even seen online video of the RV-15, but now it's finally unveiled. The real airplane has flown here from Oregon, and it's here in person.
So, on the nose of the airplane is a Hartzell 80-inch Trailblazer constant speed composite prop, and it's attached to, under the cowls, an IO390 EXP119 engine from Lycoming. The best way I can describe that combination in terms of what I've seen and what we've talked about is this thing's a beast, right? It's a lot of pull and a lot of power for a relatively light airplane. And we're pretty excited about what we've seen and what we've learned so far in the initial flight. And as we continue to fly, I'm pretty confident it's gonna continue to perform really, really well. So this looks like solid spring gear from the outside, but in reality it's not. But under here, on each side are two oil nitrogen shocks, right, that are opposing each other and which allow this gear to articulate in this sort of a manner, up and down, to absorb the shock not only coming out but also to dampen the return. So one of the things about spring gear, right, is that you get the return is what can really kind of get you. So this helps to solve that kind of problem. One of the cool things about doing that is that where normally, if you're going out in the backcountry, you might use really big tires to dampen some of that stuff. You have that built into the airplane. It's not under the airplane, it's inside where it's not a drag problem. But that allows you then to use a smaller tire, maybe not this small, if you're going out in the backcountry, but you know, a 26 or something along those size, and be able to get a little more of the effect that you get from even larger, even softer tire. A nifty latch mechanism that allows it to just open. It's really kind of similar to the way a car door would work. You can see how big the opening is. The beauty of it is, thank you, Rob, the beauty of it is that pretty much the size of the door opening is also the size of the window. So sitting in here and looking out is, the visibility is amazing. But the door latch, this door latch mechanism, right, allows you to basically take it, push the door shut, and there it is. So that's the mechanism that's used.
No slamming involved.
No, hopefully no slamming involved, yeah.
Show us the panel.
So the panel here is pretty standard RV. In this case, it's an advanced flight system, Dynon product. You can see that the panel got a couple different colors on the panel. It's gone through some configuration changes as we've tested and as we've moved things around, and that's really what this airplane is all about. It's about making changes and adjusting, trying new things, figuring out the ergonomics, figuring out the fit, the flyability of the airplane. That's what we're doing here.
That is a humongous flap handle.
It is. It's a big flap handle and gives you a lot of leverage, and it's manual flaps, right? And so, and if you think the flap handle is humongous, wait till you see the flaps. So the beauty of flaps is that they'll extend and they continue to extend, but at some point, after this point here, they just drop down. They're fully extended and they drop. So
that max flap setting? What's that like 40, 50 degrees?
It's 50 degrees on the test configuration. It's 50 degrees, and that's part of the configuration that we have now. Is pretty significant in terms of what you can actually extend it to. So for test purposes, we've configured it in a way that allows us to begin to explore that envelope with the flaps.
Okay, so looking at the tail, I mean, a flying tail stabilator, pull rivets, and servo tab. Why? What's the reason?
There's a couple of reasons. We have a large flap with a large deflection. That creates a large pitching moment. A stabilator or a full trimmable stabilizer are the best ways to address that, to maintain controllability. We also have a large baggage compartment that extends pretty far aft into the tail cone. So we have a wide CG envelope. And again, the stabilator's an easy way to address that.
This is the first high wing airplane Vance has ever designed, and it's made for the backcountry.
Unimproved type of strip, maybe someplace like Johnson Creek and grass, or something that's a little more difficult, something that maybe you wouldn't take an RV-4 or some other airplane into. And it will meet the total performance. It's a basic requirement, right? So we want to go as high, as fast as we can on the envelope. We want to go as low and as slow as we can. But critically important is that it needs to also be balanced in terms of the affordability, the ability to build it, right? And critically speaking is the handling characteristics of the airplane. It needs to fly, it needs to be an RV.
But don't expect these airplanes to show up at your home airfield anytime soon.
When will these be available to purchase?
But, it's not now, it won't be this year. But as we get closer to that time, we'll be able to let people know.
Dick Van Grunsven, the founder of Vans Aircraft, insists on doing things in a certain order.
Better do something right or people, again, the expectations get pretty high.
Well, Vans has been pretty quiet about the aircraft since AirVenture, but we did see it at the High Sierra flying in October, and here's a little bit of drone footage of the aircraft taxiing out there on the desert. So it'll be interesting to see what's to come from them regarding the RV-15 in 2023. Well, the new Kodiak 900 also debuted to a lot of fanfare during EAA AirVenture, and we actually got a sneak peek at it. Retired AOPA editor-in-chief Tom Haynes got to fly it in eastern Washington.
It's a cold, blustery June day in eastern Washington state as we crank up the new Kodiak 900. The goal for the new airplane is to keep the utility Kodiak is known for while adding speed, space, and refinement.
So we had a really successful product in the Kodiak 100, and we are always constantly thinking of how can we make this product better, and we're listening to our customers and what they need and what they want.
A major boost in power is immediately noticeable. Even with four aboard and nearly full fuel, the airplane rockets off this gravel strip in about 1,000 feet.
We are looking at a climb rate of about 1,800 feet per minute. It climbs like a homesick angel. It's pretty fun.
And cruise speed at altitude is much faster than a Kodiak 100.
What we're tracking towards is about 210 knots, true airspeed at about 12,500 feet.
That's 35 knots faster. That speed is partially thanks to a more powerful variant of the Pratt & Whitney PT6, producing 900 shaft horsepower, 200 more than the original. Engineers also work to clean up drag.
So we added a few drag reduction pieces of equipment. So the most noticeable being the wheel fairings on all three wheels. We put in flat track fairings. And then the cargo pod on this new Kodiak is integrated into the airframe. So every airplane will have the cargo pod. We were able to make it basically an integral part of the airplane. And so the nose cone into the cargo pod all looks like it's supposed to be there.
For as big as it is, the airplane is fairly light on the controls. Like the latest models of the Kodiak 100 Series 3, the 900 has the Garmin G1000 NXI cockpit and the GFC 700 autopilot. Meanwhile, behind the pilots, there are several changes to the larger interior. The new Kodiak is stretched more than 3 feet.
Every seat has a new amenity panel with headset jacks. Every seat has USB ports, phone holders, cup holders. We have all new seats in the new Kodiak. And so the seats are really interesting because they can be turned fore or aft. The new Kodiak, you can actually do double club configuration like we have here. You can have all forward facing seats. You don't have to have multiple seat types. The airplane will come with one seat type, which will really hit all markets.
The 900 was designed to please pilot owners and commercial operators.
To be able to carry 10 passengers, potentially even 12 in the future, and go 210 knots in an unpressurized airplane that can still take off and land in less than 1,500 feet, there's nothing that can really do that right now, especially in the $3 million to $4 million ballpark price range for a new aircraft.
With the included wheel fairings and other changes, the Kodiak 900 is not quite as optimized for the shortest, most rugged strips in the backcountry like the 100, but it still offers plenty of performance for rough strips and out-of-the-way places.
It definitely has the heritage of the Kodiak line, just with a little bit more refinement, a little bit more luxury, and certainly a lot more speed.
Well, new aircraft weren't the only thing that captured the attention of our YouTube viewers. So did high-profile pilots who made questionable decisions and got in trouble with the FAA. Well-known aviator and Flying Magazine columnist Martha Lunken had flown under a bridge in Ohio in 2021. The FAA revoked her pilot certificates, and we caught up with her earlier this year in January, just after she had gotten her private pilot certificate back at 14,000 hours. And here's what she had to say about her decision-making and admitting that she shouldn't have flown under the bridge.
All righty. Well, thank you, Martha Lunken, for joining us this afternoon, celebrating a little bit of a milestone, a private pilot certificate redo. How many years between your first and your second private pilot check ride, if I might be
60.
Okay.
Yeah, March of 1962 when I got the first private license.
And the second was pretty recently, yes?
Yeah, it was Christmas Eve of this December 2021. So the best Christmas present ever.
A lot of people are happy to hear that you're flying again. I assume none more than you yourself.
Tell me
what you've been doing with it.
Well, you know, during the 9 months that I was in purgatory, I have several friends at the airport where I keep my Cessna 180, and I would fly along as a passenger. So, you know, I maintain some degree of proficiency, and I've owned that airplane for 30 years. So, you know, it's kind of like riding a bike, although a 180 can be a little squirrely on hard surface. So I took 3 hours in preparation for the private check ride and the private practical test with a wonderful guy up at Waynesville Airport, north of Cincinnati. So anyway, we decided I would take the test in the 1967 Cessna 150. And I have about close to 6,000 hours instructing in Cessna 150s. I had one in my flying school. But, you know, that was 50 years ago. So I had to do a little homework on the numbers and the weight and balance and all that. And then I went through the private pilot questions, you know, for the oral. Christmas Eve morning wasn't ideal, but it was better than it has been. And I drove up to Waynesville and we flew the check ride in that Cessna 150. And, you know, it was a joy to fly. I mean, I have to tell you, I love J3 Cubs. I love DC-3s. I love Lockheed Lodestars and BH-18s and Cessna 180s. But there's something about, especially an older Cessna 150, that's just, it's a sweet airplane. It's a fun airplane to fly. So, but we did do a very complete flight check and oral, and the flight check took about 2 hours. And I got a little bit lost because he wouldn't let me use the VOR or my iPad. But I found myself, so all was well. And then when I came back home to Lunken, I flew with an instructor who signed me off for high performance, complex, and tailwheel. So I immediately leaped into my 180 and have been flying it lots ever since. I always feel like the Lord works in mysterious ways. And as painful as this was, and it was very, very painful, and unexpected, I connected with so many people. Now, a few of them thought I should go to jail. But the vast majority were very supportive. And I've wondered about that why that is. And I think, well, A, they know I love to fly. And B, this kind of shenanigans is something probably everybody has thought about doing at one time or another, especially people who have been around for a long time. And thirdly, we live in a really rule-bound society. And I think that idea was something that impacted on people. Certainly what I did was illegal, and I knew it. It was not dangerous.
Did it come up at all during the examination, the check ride?
Well, not directly, but as we took off and initially headed on course, my first checkpoint was this big, beautiful bridge, the Jeremiah Morrow Bridge, which I knew well. Yeah. We went over it.
But you said you were surprised that the FAA responded, went all the way to revocation, and I assume was the surprise, where they had options available to them under the regs, you know, suspension, for example.
Yeah, and I think the explanation for that was when I got a call a week later from the local FAA office, and I know very few people in there anymore. And the first question was, did you fly your airplane under the bridge, the Morrow Bridge? And I said, yes, I did. And the second question was, did you turn your transponder off? And I said, no, I did not. And I received a letter of investigation about 2 weeks later, a formal LOI. And meanwhile, I had called Kathy Yotis in Washington, who you guys know well, and put her to work for me. But the interesting thing was that a year went by with no word from the FAA, nothing. Well, after 6 months, an FAA violation, if it's not acted upon, usually disappears, but there's usually an off-the-hook letter that's sent out. But in my case, I received nothing, and Kathy couldn't quite understand it. And then 6 months later, almost to a year after the incident, I received a formal emergency letter of revocation saying, you know, you are obviously unsafe, impure, unclean, and all kinds of things. So, you know, the question is, if I'm that unsafe, why did they let me fly for a year? And I have no idea why, but I did. I did fly for that year. And we talked it over, and it seems that they insist on believing that I intentionally turned off my transponder. I did not. I did not turn it off. But, you know, it's a hard thing. I mean, I don't want any kid or anybody to go flying under a bridge, although you'd be amazed at how many of them confessed to me that they hit. I don't want to say, hey, this was really cool. You guys should try this. No. And I'm sorry it got out in public because it might give that impression.
Well, the other high-profile pilots actually performed stunts with their aircraft that were considered careless or reckless and landed them in a lot of hot water, to say the least. One was former Olympic snowboarder Trevor Jacob, who bailed out of his Taylorcraft in late 2021. The FAA revoked his certificates in 2022. Then the other incident is the two Red Bull pilots who tried to swap planes in midair. One of the aircraft crashed, and the Red Bull pilots did this after the FAA had denied their petition to try this stunt. So let's take a look.
We want to update you on the Trevor Jacob saga. He documented the entire ordeal with cameras mounted at several different places on his airplane and filmed his bailout and parachute down and then subsequent hike to find his airplane with a selfie stick. He posted a video of the event about 30 days afterwards. The video immediately drew suspicion from the aviation community that it was all a stunt. And according to the New York Times, the FAA agreed. On April 11th, they sent Mr. Jacob a letter, an emergency order of revocation, which immediately revoked his pilot's license. According to the FAA, he violated 91.13 and operated his aircraft in a careless and reckless manner. In their letter, the FAA alleges certain aspects of the video that indicate the entire event was a stunt. For example, they mentioned that Mr. Jacob never tried to start his engine. He never looked for an emergency landing spot, even though there were multiple places he could have landed the airplane within view of the video. He never tried to contact air traffic control. He boarded his airplane with a backpack parachute, which is highly unusual. That's what the FAA alleges. And then online, in more video content, other people from the aviation community saw even more suspicious activity, like he mounted a fire extinguisher to his leg, which you could see as he bailed out of the airplane. If Mr. Jacob failed to report the incident in time to the NTSB, if he made false statements to the NTSB, or if he didn't preserve the wreckage so that the NTSB could conduct an investigation, the NTSB can turn that over to the Department of Justice, which would involve criminal investigation. So to help us understand that more, I've reached out to Jared Allen, the Deputy General Counsel here at AOPA, to help us understand the legal trouble that Mr. Jacob may still find himself in. So Jared, thanks for joining us. A couple of questions here. If some of these allegations are true about, you know, further problems, for example, isn't there a requirement to report an accident to the NTSB, and what happens if you don't?
That's correct, Richard. So as all pilots should be familiar, there are accident and serious incident reporting requirements in the NTSB's rules. Those are in 49 CFR Part 830. And those rules have to be closely examined since they do require that immediate notification be given of certain events.
What happens if you don't? What happens if you don't provide that notification?
Sure. So thankfully, this is not something we see too often because most pilots, once they are aware of an event and they hopefully speak to someone knowledgeable about what's going on or they're familiar with the rules, they make the reports. However, in those rare cases where the notification isn't provided, the NTSB, from our experience, will typically reach out and ask for the information. But ultimately, if it's not provided, they can pursue basically a civil penalty, generally a fine, against the operator of the aircraft, which would include the owner or even the pilots involved. For certain events, what's perhaps even more concerning is that the NTSB, although they can only assert a fine against an individual, they can refer the matter to the Department of Justice to investigate potential criminal penalties. So that's something that rarely happens, but it is a possibility.
Yeah. And speaking of trouble with the FAA, two Red Bull pilots attempted to bail out of their airplanes and transfer into each other's airplanes and then fly them safely to the ground. The stunt went wrong. An aircraft was destroyed and a pilot parachuted to the ground. What's troubling about this incident is the Red Bull pilots requested permission from the FAA to do the stunt. They requested a waiver. The FAA denied their request only 2 days prior to when the pilots performed the stunt anyway. Can you speak to that about, one, just the general idea of you request permission, you're denied, and you do it anyway, how the FAA is likely to look at that?
It's going to be very difficult for those involved, and perhaps including the airmen, to argue that they weren't aware that this would be a regulatory violation. Just by the very nature of having sought an exemption, apparently at least someone believed that it was needed. So where we're at now, if the investigation moves forward, I would expect that the FAA investigators and inspectors will review the evidence, compile a list of potential regulatory violations. Ultimately, the investigatory material will end up in the hands of an FAA attorney who will review it, and they'll decide how to prosecute the case in the best interest of the FAA, which allegations should be alleged. But as part of that process, I would expect that they'll look at what they call aggravating and mitigating factors in determining what the sanction should be for any certificated airman involved or the operators. And as we've seen in other cases, some very recently, a single act in and of itself can be severe enough to demonstrate that someone lacks the qualifications to hold any pilot certificate, resulting in a revocation. And that's typically when the FAA can establish that something demonstrates that an airman just does not have the skill, care, or judgment to hold a certificate. So it will be interesting to see what the investigation here reveals and what the ultimate outcome is, but it's clear that there are some concerns for those involved.
It's hard to argue with the FAA because of the end result of the stunt was exactly one of the things they were worried about. So, Jared, thanks so much for your time. It's always insightful to talk to you to see the angles that will come at from the legal perspective, either in defending it or from the sort of enforcement side.
Well, thanks for having me, Richard.
These stunts disappointed us. Here at AOPA, we protect the freedom to fly, to grow general aviation, to protect it and to keep it safe in just about any form, but not this.
Well, AOPA Air Safety Institute Senior Vice President Richard McSpadden joins me now to talk about pilot decision-making and safety. Richard, thanks for joining me.
Hey, Alyssa. Happy holidays.
Thanks. All right. So Martha, Trevor, and the Red Bull pilots, you know, what they did was questionable on the safety and the regulatory front. What can pilots do? What decision-making should they go through if they get a wild idea or, you know, a sudden impulse when they're flying in the air to do something that could be risky or frowned upon? What questions should we ask ourselves, you know, to kind of just check us in that moment?
Yeah, it's a good question, Alyssa. You know, what we've learned in aviation is that, let's take the in-flight stuff first. Be really careful of impromptu decisions, even if they're not on the edge of regulatory guidance. But whenever we're airborne and we decide, oh, let me drop down and take a look at this river or circle around this wildlife or something, impromptu decisions add risk to our flying. So anytime that we think about something in the moment and decide something impromptu, it's just sort of a yellow flag that lets pause and step back and think about what we're about to do before we actually go do it. And especially if it involves low altitude. Impromptu decisions are tough, they add risk. When they involve low altitude, that accelerates the risk.
Okay, thanks. Now, it seems like we've had, you know, a lot of accidents and incidents this year. And I know just, you know, the second half of the year, there's at least has been a handful of midair collisions. And what's our safety record like so far in 2022?
Yeah, so the good news is that we're still in historically low fatal accident rates as far as our rates go. Fiscal year 2022 was higher than 21 because 21 was such an exceptionally low year. We had a record-setting year, best year we've ever had in fiscal year 2021. So in 2022, we had more accidents, but we also had more activity. GA activity went up by more than 10% in 2022. We're up to about 26.2 million flight hours in 2022. So that's something to keep in mind, that typically when we see activity level go up, we also see the number of accidents go up. And that's the case in just about any endeavor.
Okay. And what advice do you have for us to start 2023 off on the safe foot?
You know, the best advice I have is that for most of us, our peak proficiency is in the tail end of the summer. Because you can track GA activity, it tends to die off in the winter, naturally weather gets bad, and then it picks up about March, and it peaks in the summertime, and then it starts to fall off again about October. And so for most of us to remember that when we come back to our flying, whether or not we go sporadically in the winter or we go in the spring, to remember we're not going to be at the proficiency we left at back in the fall. So don't expect from ourselves and from our airplanes what we had when we stopped flying 3 or 4 months ago or when we were at peak proficiency. So kind of walk your way back into your flying and start with, you know, relatively vanilla flying that you can do very comfortably, and then, you know, push yourself more as your proficiency grows.
Oh, okay. That's wonderful advice, Richard. Well, happy new year to you.
You too. Thanks for listening.
Thanks. Well, happy new year to all of you. I hope you enjoyed this episode of Fly with AOPA. And be sure to like and subscribe so you get all the latest videos. Now, this week, we leave you with some excellent video footage from AOPA member Andy Miranda landing his MAL MX-7-180 at Cabin Creek, Idaho. Be sure to send in your favorite flying videos at the link in the description. You just might see them on an upcoming show. And as always, if you're not already an AOPA pilot, we'd love for you to join us. Click the link at the end of the video to learn more.